I just want to thank everybody, and I would like to thank the whole world what it has done for my family today, especially George. But I just want to make this statement. The world knows George Floyd. I know Perry Jr. He was a pesky little rascal. But we all loved him. And I just want to thank all the mothers that are here today. And if you've got a nephew, an uncle, just hug them and just let them know. We are for all these young black men that are coming up in this world today. And just hug them and love them, because we don't ever know when the time will come. I just want to thank each and every one of you. I have gained such a huge family all over the world. I have so many sisters and brothers now. I have aunts and uncles, and I just want to thank you all. There's too many names to remember, but God knows in his heart that I love this Floyd family, I love my sister, and I can't talk about George Perry Jr. unless I bring up his mother's name. Everybody, Everyone know her as Miss Sissy in Third Ward Cutie Home, Texas. And I just want to say I love you. I love all the support, and my family know I do.
Yeah, I love you.
And we all are one. Thank you.
I just want to say that I'm gonna miss my brother a whole lot, and I almost want to say to him, I love you, and I thank God for giving me my own personal Superman. God bless you all.
First off, I want to say, hello, my name is Brooke Williams, George Floyd's niece, and I can breathe. As long as I'm breathing, justice will be served for Perry. First off, I want to thank all of you for coming out to support George Perry Floyd. My uncle was a father, brother, uncle, and a cousin to many. Spiritually grounded and activist, he always moved people with his words. Their officer showed no remorse while watching my uncle's soul leave his body. He begged and pleaded many times just for you to get up, but you just pushed harder. Why must this system be corrupt and broken? Laws were already put in place for the African-American system to fail. And these laws need to be changed. No more hate crimes, please. Someone said make America great again, but when has America ever been great? Officers were literally on him for 9 minutes, and none of them showed they have a heart or soul. This is not just murder, but a hate crime. I shared happy memories with my uncle. Now that's all I have are memories. I still can't pull myself together to how he's calling my grandma a name. I believe my grandmother was right there with open arms saying, come home, baby. You shouldn't feel this pain. No one should feel this pain. My most favorite memory with my uncle was when he paid me to scratch his head at the long days of work. We arrived at home. We even created a song about it called Scratch My Head, Scratch My Head. Yeah. But after that, I knew he was a comedian. He always told me, baby girl, you're going to go so far with that beautiful smile and brains of yours. Another favorite memory is when me and my grandmother was so worried. I mean, she was crying. All I remember is me saying, Granny, it's okay. We'll find a way. But I wasn't entirely sure about how we were going to get to my uncle's PJ's wedding. We had nowhere to contact anyone. But here comes my uncle, busting through the door like Superman. I was young, by the way, probably 10 or 11. My grandmother was also handicapped. And he had this big truck we had to ride in. I was wondering, how was my grandmother going to get in that truck? But he just placed it in the truck like it was light work. I never questioned anyone's strength, but it was unbelievable how my uncle and grandmother broke their backs to always see their children smile and made a way when it seemed impossible. Quote, Tupac, I'm sorry, y'all. Changes. You see, the old way wasn't working, so it's on us to do what we gotta do to survive. America, it is time for a change. Even if it shall begin with more protests, no justice, no peace. My brother and basically my other mom tells me this all the time, but God says high, but he looks low. Thank you, Houston. It's always love in the hometown.
I really don't know what to say after my niece, but she told the whole story But I wake up in the middle of the night thinking about my brother a lot, because I couldn't believe it at first. But I see it now. All I think about is when he was yelling for mama. And I know how mama is. She just right there. She got her hands wide open. Come here, baby. Every mama felt that. But when he yelled, please, please, I can't breathe, I stopped wearing ties. I didn't want to wear a tie no more because I wanted to be able to breathe. I went to memorials, no tie. I could have had one on, but right now, I want justice for my brother, my big brother. That's Big Floyd. Everybody know who Big Floyd is now. Third Ward, CUNY Homes, that's where we was born at, but we're gonna be remembered. Everybody gonna remember him around the world. He's gonna change the world. My mom, if she was here today, I honestly can say this, that she will be on that casket right now, trying to get in there with him. She's a real mom. A real mom. She's not gonna separate from anybody. She's just like animals. They cling to their mom. I love y'all. Y'all showed a lot of support. I love y'all. I'm speechless right now.
Good afternoon. My name is Cyril White, and I am the director of To God Be the Glory Sports. Before I came to director of To God Be the Glory Sports, I met Big Floyd. I spent so many of my college summers playing basketball with him. He had a good friend named Mike Riggs who went to Worthing, and I would go pick up Mike Riggs and we would go get Big Floyd. We'd be at Nettleton Park and McGregor Park and Sunnyside Park or wherever we can go find a good game. Well, then fast forward to 1998, I started a college exhibition tour team touring around the country, going to play different colleges and exhibition games. And Big Floyd, that was my first power forward. I would be calling around trying to get contracts with the different schools, and the coaches would ask me, who's your big man? I would say, George Floyd. They say, oh, you got Big Floyd. Okay, well, your team must be pretty good. And so then we would go off and play. And not only did George play on the team, but he recruited a lot of other guys from Third Ward and the CUNY Homes to come and join me. And a lot of those guys got college scholarships, and some of those guys even played professionally overseas. So it's been well established how much George Floyd was an avid sports fan and always about sports. And I was sharing with Lil Wu earlier this week that I've already secured a commitment for 3 acres of land here in Houston to do a George Floyd Memorial Sports Center. I just kept thinking about what could I do, and I had a lot of support from around the world from my different sponsors, and yes, I had one guy step up and said, hey Cyril, I can definitely provide the real estate, and we just work on the vertical improvement. So that's where we are with that. One thing that we did, I'm going to get out here fast, at To God Be the Glory Sports, we read the Proverbs. That's what was our spiritual exercise, to try to grow in practical wisdom as young men. We would read a chapter of Proverbs. Everybody would read 2 verses out loud, and then they pass the Bible to the next guy. Right? So Sylvester Turner, our honorable mayor, said that today is George Floyd Day. So I'm going to read Proverbs chapter 6, the 6th and verse 9 through 11. And this is Big Floyd speaking. It says, how long will you lie there, you sluggard? When will you get up from your sleep? A little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to rest, and poverty will come on you like a thief, and scarcity like an armed man. Well, I can definitely see how Big Floyd has woken us up out of our sleep, correct? I mean, we're all up from our sleep. We are not slumbering anymore. This poverty and this scarcity talked about in Scripture, that is how we treat each other, humanity. We are poor in humanity. We are poor in empathy. But I can feel that everyone is going to rise against injustice, and be sure that all human beings are treated the same so that George Floyd's memory will not be in vain. To the family, thank you for allowing me to speak and share this memory about Big Floyd, and to God be the glory to you all. Thank you very much.
You know, hearing everyone speak thus far about Big Floyd, I mean, great brother, we got a great family on stage, great family in this church house today, CUNY Hall family, extended family, Founder Praise Church, thank everybody. And one thing, you know, I'm being strong for my family, and one thing about Big Floyd, he'll tell me right in the little bro, be strong. Just be thankful for day to day, and just celebrate his life and happiness. He wouldn't want us weeping so hard, but you know, I'm trying, but it's very hard. I mean, I got so many great memories to share, stories to tell, but you know, they're just getting stuck inside. And again, you know, I got it. Oh man, but one of the best own things on my mind, honestly, we gotta seek this justice out for my brother, and we gonna get it together. Everyone in this church, all the great city councilmen and women in this crowd, thank you very much, Sheila. Oh my God, Sheila Jackson Lee, thank you, Master Best Eternal, Earl Green, and the rest of you guys for comforting and calling us, letting us know for the last couple of days and week. Giving us y'all major support, and everyone in the world, again, for the major support and love that y'all sharing and giving, inboxing, sharing these beautiful pictures. Thank you guys. And we're gonna keep this fight on, and we're gonna do this together, and we all in it together, and we're gonna finish this together. And united we stand, and again, we're standing for George Floyd, and thank everyone that came, showing love.
Once one more time, his life mattered, all our lives matter, black lives matter. His death would not be in vain. What's his name?
First of all, I want to give all my honor and praise to God for giving me a chance at life and meeting my little brother. For giving him his first security job. My little brother, was a friend, he was a mentor, he was a father, he was a basketball player, he was a football player, but most of all, he was a human being. And if I tell you, I never could say no to this kid, out of all the flaws and trials and tribulations that we go through, what we went through, all the times he can make me mad and make everybody mad, we still love him. I couldn't say no. So when the family came to me and asked me, did you go speak? I will speak, I will keep on speaking, I will fight. I will fight, because I've been fighting for him, and I will keep on fighting for him. You know, we ask ourselves who we meet and who we come in encounter with in life. I came in encounter with, and we all came in encounter with, if you knew him, a ghetto angel. A ghetto angel. A brother, you know, you hate evil, but you love good. And what my brother was, my little bro, was good. You can't slam his name with me. You can't talk bad about him to me, as I knew him. And if you knew Floyd, If you know Jew, if you knew Jew, you understand the words coming out of my mouth. And I ask you, fight for my brother. Help me fight for my brother. Help the family fight for my brother. Because he was someone. Thank you. Family thanks you. And I will not give up on you, bro. I love you, little bro. And I got you.
You should be on your feet right now, giving the glory to God right now. Get on your feet. Give him the glory. Give him the glory. Give God the glory. Give Flawed the glory. Give his kids the glory. Give his family the glory. To my pastor, I love you. Amir, I love you too. My frat brother. George Floyd. Anybody in here play football for Jack Yates or went to Jack Yates? Walked the halls of Jack Yates or Ryan. We're gonna say Cullen too. Stand up. Stand up. George Floyd was an all-American tight end. George Floyd was a power forward, was my power forward. So I'm speaking on the behalf of my brother. Blood, sweat, and tears every single day. It's hot outside. It's hot in the gym. Not one time did I ever see George Floyd complain. Not one time. He, without sin, cast the first stone. Huh? He without sin cast the first stone. I hear everybody talking. Y'all want the real or y'all want the fake? You want the real today, right? My brother, he's sitting here. He didn't have to be sitting here today. Those men that stood on my brother's neck changed the world. They took somebody from us that was great. When I say great, I never heard him complain, not one time. He was an umbrella to all of us. He was 6'6". Any rain came our way, he made sure that he could cover for us. From the CUNY home to Jack Yates High, he was everybody's shelter. Everybody's shelter. I don't care what George Floyd did. I don't care. Let me tell y'all something. He was a human being, first of all. I couldn't sleep Monday night. I don't know why. I couldn't sleep. I was tossing and turning Memorial Day in my bed. I don't know why. As I woke up the next morning and got so many texts, and I said, what? I haven't even seen the whole tape. It hurts my heart, y'all. We all hurt in America right now. Am I right or wrong? But one thing, but God, because all we need right now in this world today is what? Love. Turn to your neighbor and tell him you love him right now. Turn to him right now and tell him you love him. That's all we need. You see how that feel? George Floyd told me he loved me. He told everybody out here that he touched, he loved them. George Floyd is love. That's who George Floyd is. This is for him. We love him. If you love George Floyd and you know how George Floyd was with you, you know you're gonna always be George Floyd. I am George Floyd. You are George Floyd. That could have been anyone else in here but God. God said, well done, Floyd. So as I sit here and tell you all right now, George Floyd is in the bosom of God. He's in the bosom of God. He's all right, y'all. So I'm here to tell y'all, stay positive, America. It's a debt that you have to repay. But God said, not this debt. You're gonna have to repay it. This is the last. So as I sit here and I see it, so many people coming together, so many races, and I say, you know what? Because of the love of George Floyd, we are all here together today. So make sure you turn to your people. You never know how long we got, y'all. You never know. The key is love. I love y'all. Brady Ball, come out.
Hey, what's going on, everybody? Much love and strength to the family of George Floyd. Much love and strength to the family members that are here, of anybody that's been lost. 50 states all protesting at the same time. This man changed the world. Changed the world for the better. So I just want to personally thank George Floyd for his sacrifice so that my kids can be all right later on. I appreciate the sacrifice, my brother. I genuinely do. Sorry, I ain't coming up here to talk. All right. How do I say goodbye to what we had? The good times that made us laugh, I'll wait back. I thought we'd get to see forever, but forever's gone away. It's so hard. To yesterday, I don't know where this road is going to lead. All I know is where we've been and what we've been through. If we get to see tomorrow, I hope it's worth all the pain. It's so hard to say goodbye to yesterday. And I'll take the memories to be my sunshine after the rain. It's so hard to say goodbye to yesterday.
God bless. afternoon. My name is Ernicia Dangerfield, and I am honored to stand before you today, honored to share what George Floyd meant to our alumni, Jack Gates Senior High School, our community, of course, his children, family, his friends, and now the world. 3260 Truxillo is where it all began. And if you could carry the whole community on your back or work to help your fam, you do it with your bare hands. To make a way out, your gift with the ball helped to create your vision and infiltrate a plan. And now, beyond the streets of Third Ward, your legacy will stand. Your children will be honored to witness your contributions firsthand. You didn't make excuses, but stood tall and accepted your responsibilities like a real man. Such a gentle giant. Although his 6'6" stature could intimidate some men, your smile was your way of creating an openness, greeting a stranger with a dab and your hand. Always repping H-Town. Know what I'm saying? Speaking about unity, right here in the community, calling old heads to action, to take a stand against violence and rebuke it. While you were working and traveling from coast to coast, sometimes met with oppositions, but still so inspiring and filled with so much hope, everyone listened when you spoke. Familiar faces became family, and not just blood made them kinfolk. But there's a message in it all, because all of us are beyond woke. The pinnacle for you is something we will never know. Undoubtedly though, the seeds you planted will manifest and fully grow. Only you could bring the world together, George Floyd. A life of VIP to a sold out show. My prayers, condolences, and love to the family. We will forever honor George Floyd. Thank you.
My nephew, PJ, my niece, Keita, and the rest of the Floyd family. There's peace behind this. There's love behind this. Although a storm was raising, you had no idea. Someone had just changed the whole world, and it happened to be in your family. I have sung this song so many times, at so many funerals and homecomings. This is one that really touched me right here. Though the storms keep on raging in my life, yeah, sometimes it's hard to tell the nights from day. Still that hope that lies within us reassures. As I keep my eyes upon the distant shore, I know he'll lead you safe. That blessed place he has prepared. But if
changing in my life. And sometimes it's hard to tell the nights from day. Still that hope that lies within is beyond our soul. As I keep my eyes upon the peace of sure, I know he'll lead me safely to that blessed place he has prepared. But if the song
to say thank you.
offer praise. Oh yes, we offer praise. Oh Lord, we give you praise. You
The fact that it was difficult for everyone else to stay within their time limit. Thank you, Dr. Wright, for your auspicious leadership. My privilege and my honor today, as we give honor to the family of George Floyd, is to introduce today a man who needs no introduction, but deserves one. Born October 3rd, 1954, Al Sharpton. Grew up like most of us, raised like most of us in church. His Sunday school teacher had no idea what she was teaching. His pastor had no idea who he was preaching to. His teachers had no idea who they were teaching. But since that time, he has become a social justice activist, a civil rights leader, a talk show host, a commentator, a leader of movements, a world changer, a freedom fighter, a preacher amongst preachers. When Officer Chauvin put his knee on the neck of George Floyd, he had no idea that the man whose life he was taking would be important enough to have this preacher to preach his eulogy. He probably thought it would end quietly in some obscure funeral home with a few people. But he had no idea that presidents of nations would think and write about him, and that the preacher who would preach the service would be the greatest civil rights preaching voice of our time. And we've talked much about how we change things, but when God wants to change things, he brings a person to the earth. And when this preacher was birthed, God knew there'd be moments like this where it would take someone's voice to speak truth to power prophetically that would change the world. And I hope that when we hear this preacher, all America understands that yes, we can change policies and legislation, but if we want to change this situation, white parents have to teach their boys to be brothers to black boys. We have to teach our daughters to be sisters, whether you're black, white, or brown. Because when George Floyd was gasping for breath saying, "I can't breathe," he was speaking the language of 400 years of Africans in this country. We couldn't breathe on the slave ships. We couldn't breathe in Jim Crow. We couldn't breathe through segregation. We couldn't breathe through mass incarceration. We couldn't breathe. And there's been a preacher on the scene for the last four decades telling us, Americans, we can't breathe in Bensonhurst. We can't breathe when Trayvon Martin in Sanford. We can't breathe. And this preacher is here today in Houston, Texas, because George Floyd died saying, "We can't breathe." I want you to welcome to this pulpit today the iconic preaching voice, anointed preaching personality of the Reverend Dr. Al Sharpton, our voice, our fighter, our leader, our freedom fighter. And because of him, guess what? One day all of us are going to breathe better. Let's stand and receive the Honorable Reverend Al Sharpton.
First of this family, the whole family that has suffered this crime. I hear people talk about what happened to George Floyd like there was something less than a crime. This was not just a tragedy. It was a crime. And this family has borne this, those, and I'm going to announce all of them that I'm giving. Because this is a time that we need to understand that they're going to do everything they can to delay these trials and delay the accountability and try to wear this family down. And many that are standing and coming today and skinning and grinning in front of cameras will not be here for the long run. We must commit to this family, all of these families, all five of his children, grandchildren and all, that until these people paid for what they did, that we gonna be there with them, cause lives like George will not matter until somebody pays the cost for taking their lives. We cannot just act like this is some new way of teaching sociology. We can't act like this is some new need for some of us to add social justice to our programs on Sunday morning. There is an intentional neglect to make people pay for taking our lives. If four blacks had done to one white, if four black cops had done to one white, what was done to George They wouldn't have to teach no new lessons. They wouldn't have to get corporations to get money. They would send them to jail. And until we know the price for black life is the same as the price for white life, we're going to keep coming back to these situations over and over again. Either the law will work or it won't work. So I want to give honor to the family and a commitment that we're going to be here for the long haul. When the last TV truck is gone, we'll still be here. I've gotten to know some of the family over the last few days. I've seen them cry in private. I've seen them talk. I told them I grew up in black family. I know we always don't get along. I got some cousins watching me now that better never call me. That's what families are. But I've also seen them in light moments. I'll never forget last week when the family part that was there talked with former President Obama on the phone and said, we're not asking you to come because it'll take all the Secret Service stuff and all that, but we just want to thank you and your wife for calling and calling our name of our brother, our uncle, during the speeches you've been making. And the president made the mistake of asking, well, what is it y'all want me to do? Just tell me where I could be helpful. And Filonis said, well, two things. We want justice. And we here in Minneapolis, can you send me some food down here? Because they only had the finger food. Everything was closed up in Minneapolis. He said, I ain't on Reverend Al's diet. I want some food. So we had some light moments. I want to also say, give honor to Reverend Dr. Remus Wright and Reverend Mia Wright. For opening the doors of this church and putting their arms around Sabrina and her family at this hour. They know this is going to be controversial in some circles, yet they opened the doors anyway, not knowing what would happen, not knowing how people would behave. And as I spoke with him on the phone and he welcomed his family, I think we are giving them a lot of or we should not take them for granted. And I think that they are deserving of a lot of honor. He's a man and she's a woman of courage. We have too many holy punks in the pulpit. Y'all do know I'm Al Sharpton. I'm gonna say what I gotta say. Let's give a hand to our pastor, Remus Wright, and Sister Mia Wright. I also want to, and I'm going to get into my eulogy so we can stay on time, but I must recognize Attorney Ben Crump. I call him Black America's Attorney General, probably because we don't feel we have one. Ben Crump has fought and stood for many cases, and he has with him a legal team, I'm sure that'll be acknowledged, that are here, Brother Stewart, Lee Merritt, and them. We should not take for granted when black lawyers take these cases like Crump has. They are targeted by their bar associations. They're targeted by people that are envious and jealous. We need civil rights lawyers that are there for civil rights, not for civil settlements. And that's why I give him recognition. I must also recognize several families are here that came at great sacrifice, but they wanted to be here to be part of this because they understand the pain better than anyone because they've gone through the pain. And I think that we should recognize the mother of Trayvon Martin. Will you stand? The mother of Eric Garner, will you stand? The sister of Botham John, will you stand? The family of Pamela Turner right here in Houston, will you stand? The father of Michael Brown from Ferguson, Missouri, will you stand? The father of Ahmed Aubrey, will you stand? All of these families came to stand with this family because they know better than anyone else the pain they will suffer from the loss that they have gone through. I also want to thank all of those that helped to make this as easy as they could for the family. Certainly we thank again those in the financial and entertainment world that immediately jumped up and said to the family that they wanted to help and make sure that they didn't have to worry about expense. Tyler Perry and Robert Smith and champion Floyd Mayweather. And others that have come, it means a lot because it shows the world the weight of this. Brother Jamie Foxx is with us today. Stand up, Jamie. Al B. Shaw is in the house today. So let me get into my message. I got Terrell Owens, everybody's sending me notes. Want you to turn briefly to the book of Ephesians, 6th chapter. Ephesians is 6th chapter because I think that we need to understand what we're dealing with here. Ephesians 6 chapter, it tells the story of why I think we need to really look at the situation differently. Because it talks about, in Paul's letter to the Philippians, Ephesians, okay, I'm catching up with myself. It says in his letter to the Ephesians, he says, finally be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against rulers and authorities, against the powers of the darkness, against spiritual forces of wickedness in high places. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so when the day of evil comes, ye may be able to withstand your ground. May God add a blessing to the reading of his word. We are not fighting some disconnected incidents. We are fighting an institutional systemic problem that has been allowed to permeate since we were brought to these shores. And we are fighting wickedness in high places. When you can put your knee on a man's neck and hold it there 8 minutes and 46 seconds, that's not even normal to a civilian, less known to a police officer. Try when you go home to put your knee down on something and hold it there that long. You got to be full of a lot of venom, full of something that really motivates you to press down your weight that long and not give out. And to think that you're certified by the state to carry a badge and a gun and you got all of that in you means that we have permitted people to become officers of the law that ought to be somewhere else in society. Imagine you pressing down on something 8 minutes that's telling you I can't breathe, that's begging for their life, and you keep pressing. What kind of mentality is that? So how do we screen who police officers are? And how do we get to this place over and over again? They told Eric Garner, put him in a chokehold. He said, I can't breathe. Those three cops walked, no prosecution. Until the law is upheld and people know they will go to jail, they're going to keep doing it because they're protected by wickedness in high places. How do you prevent crime in the hood? You scare others by saying if you do that, you're going to jail. Well, how are you going to scare a bad cop if bad cops don't go to jail? How are you going to tell them that your fate is going to be bad if you go on the other side of the line when everybody else got away with it? Who taught these cops that they can do this to George was those that let the cops before this get away with this. And when they have the highest level of government that excuses it, when some kids wrongly start violence that this family don't condone and none of us do, the president talks about bringing in the military, but he not said one word about 8 minutes and 46 seconds a police murder of George Floyd. Oh, he said, the family has my sympathy and all of this. He didn't give those on other situations their sympathy. He challenged China on human rights. But what about the human right of George Floyd? The signals that we're sending is that if you are in law enforcement, that the law doesn't apply to you. And I'm telling you that the law ought to especially apply to you because you're giving special powers that others don't have. We don't have a badge representing the state. We don't have a gun we're carrying. We have not gone through training. We should expect more from you. And if you break the law, you ought to be expected to pay an even higher price because you know better and you swore not to do that. So yeah, it's nice that everybody wants to now study the problem. It's nice big corporations say we're gonna throw money to study equal justice. But if we went out here and did that to a young white kid, you wouldn't need no study. You know what to do. And you know what to do now. Same Bible said, do justice. All this family wants is justice. Oh, it's nice to see some people change their mind. The head of the NFL said, yeah, maybe we was wrong. Football players, maybe they did have the right to peacefully protest. Well, don't apologize. Give Colin Kaepernick a job back. With some empty apology, take a man's livelihood, strip a man down of his talents, and 4 years later when the whole world is marching, all of a sudden you go and do a FaceTime talking about you sorry. Minimizing the value of our lives. You sorry, then repay the damage you did to the career. You stood down, cause when Colin took a knee, he took it for the families in this building, and we don't want an apology, we want him repaired. Anybody, we are trying to stop people from being anti-us. We want the law to apply equally. And you don't need a whole lot of studying about that. Yes, we need new laws. Yes, the Congress has stepped up. The Congressional Black Caucus has come. Yes, we need to close these no-knock laws. Yes, we need to stop where policemen can just say based on what they fought, they can use lethal force. Yes, we need residency requirement. All of what they propose is what we need. But we have enough right now to prosecute policemen to hold somebody down 8 minutes and 46 seconds. Man said to me, I think a lot of people are confused. I was working out. I get a workout in the morning. Man said to me, white fella in the place I was working out, said, Reverend Al, I see you on TV and you're always talking about race. I said, yeah. He said, but haven't we come a long way? I said, yeah, but you got to understand how far we have to go. And you got to understand how deep it is. He said, what do you mean? I said, about 8-9 years ago, newspaper in New York did a background on my family. And they found out, Dr. Wright, that my great-grandfather was a slave in Ellenville, South Carolina. I went down there with the newspaper and other press, and we went to the graveyard. And my great-grandfather was owned by the family of Strom Thurmond, the segregationists. And I went to the white church, the First Baptist Church, and in the graveyard there were the tombstones. And the whole about a quarter of the cemetery, the tombstones, Ben Crump, was Thurmonds and Sharptons. And I said, well, you mean all of these? They said, wait a minute, the plantation your great-grandfather was about a mile away. They buried the slaves there, they only put pebbles over their graves. So it occurred to me that every time I write my name, sir, that is not my name. That's the name of who owned my great-grandfather. That's how deep race is, that every time I write my name, I'm writing American history of what happened to my people. I can't talk about what my great-grandparents did. They were enslaved, and we're still being treated less than others. And until America comes to terms But what it has done and what it did, we will not be able to heal because you are not recognizing the wound. Floyd could have been anybody. But then the reaction was not anything. Because somewhere I read in the Bible that God said he would pour out his spirit among all flesh. And that's why when I heard them talking about, they never thought they'd see young whites marching like they marching now. All over the world, I've seen grandchildren of slave masters tearing down slave master statue over in England and put it in the river. I'll pour out my spirit among all flesh. I've seen whites walking past curfews saying no Black Lives Matter, no justice, no peace. I'll pour out my spirit among all flesh. You are now lived to where you've sown wickedness. And now you have to reap the wrath of those that don't want to be wicked no more. That a man sows, that shall he also reap. So we come because God in his own way, he always, one of the ministers said it right, God always uses unlikely people to do his will. If George Floyd had been an Ivy League school graduate and one of these ones with a long title, we would have been accused of reacting to his prominence. If he'd been a multimillionaire, they would have said that we were reacting to his wealth. If he had been a famous athlete, as he was on the trajectory to be, we would have said we were reacting to his fame. But God took an ordinary brother from the third wall, from the housing projects, that nobody thought much about but those that knew him and loved him. He took the rejected stone, the stone that the builder rejected. They rejected him for jobs. They rejected him for positions. They rejected him to play certain teams. God took the rejected stone and made him the cornerstone of a movement that's going to change the whole wide world. I'm glad he wasn't one of these polished bourgeois brothers, because we'd have still thought we was of no value. But George was just George. And now you have to understand, if you father any one of us, it's a value to all of us. Oh, if you would have had any idea that all of us would react, you'd have took your knee off his neck. If you had any idea that everybody from those in the third world to those in Hollywood would show up in Houston and Minneapolis and in Fayetteville, North Carolina, you'd have took your knee off his neck. If you had any idea that preachers, white and black, was going to line up in a pandemic, when we told to stay inside and we come out and march in the streets at the risk of our health, you'd have took your knee off his neck. Cause you thought his neck didn't mean nothing. But God made his neck to connect his head to his body, and you have no right to put your knee on that neck. Genesis 2 said that God formed man, and Jamie, they say he breathed breath, the breath of life, to make him. a live human being, which means that breath comes from God. Breath is how God gives you life. Breath is not some coincidental kind of thing that happens. Breath is a divine decision that God made. Some babies are born stillborn. God decides to blow breath in them. Breath is sanctified. Breath is sacred. You don't have the right to take God's breath out of anybody. You can't put breath in their body. But you don't look at it that way because of your wickedness. Principalities. Darkness. You're sitting now trying to figure out how you're going to stop the protest rather than how you're going to stop the brutality. You're calling your cabinet in trying to figure out how it's going to affect your vote rather than how it's going to affect our lives. You're scheming on how you can spin the story rather than you can achieve justice, wickedness in high places. You take rubber bullets and tear gas to clear out peaceful protesters and then take a Bible and walk in front of a church and use a church as a prop. Wickedness in high places. You ain't been walking across that street when the church didn't have the boards up. You weren't holding up no Bible when Aubrey was killed in Brunswick, when Taylor was killed in Louisville. Wickedness in high places. But God got some people that'll stand up. Let me tell you this. Jesus told the story that there was a man laying by the side of the road. He'd been robbed and beat. They said one man came by that was his same race, his fellow brother, and he kept walking. Then another man came by that was steeped and well read in the scriptures. Knew every scripture, knew how to quote the book back and forward. But he only quoted the book. He never lived by the book. And he kept walking. But Jesus said a third man came by. And he stopped and looked at the man. He wasn't the same race, wasn't the same religion, but he picked the man up. And he took care of restoring the man to his rightful being. And Jesus called him the Good Samaritan. The problem is too many of you been walking by the Eric Gardners, been walking by the Trayvon Martins, been walking by the Aubreys, been walking by, and now we stopped for George Floyd. And I'm in Houston today because I don't want nobody to call me a passerby. Jamie here because he's not a passerby. All of you are here because we're not passerbys. And we're going to be back in Minneapolis when the trials stop. Because you may pack the police union on one side, but the righteous is going to be on the other side of that courtroom. It's time that we reclaim the righteous in this country. Well, Reverend, we don't know if we got the money, we got the political power. Well, we got the vote. And we got something that we had before we had the vote. We had God on our side. That's why when they was even in slavery, they used to have church out in the slave quarters. Because they understood that if they called on God, that God would answer prayer. And the same God that brought us from chattel slavery is still on the throne. The same God that brought us from the back of the bus is still on the throne. The same God that brought us from Jim Crow is still on the throne. And if we're right, he'll fight our battle. And we'll put George's name in history where they said that's the one that they shouldn't have touched. That's the neck they shouldn't have been down on. Because if my people called by my name would humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from your wicked way, then you will hear from heaven and I will heal the land. I want to say, we have said we're going to keep marching. We're going to keep protesting. August 28th, we're going to Washington by the tens of thousands. We're going to have a national march on the anniversary of I Have a Dream. Floyd family and other families going to lead it. But I want to say this before I leave to the Floyd family. Don't ever forget in your darkest hour that be not dismayed. Whatever be tied, God will take care of you. I'm in Wright's church, I can preach a little bit. Beneath his wing of love abide, God will take care of you. I was like Floyd, I grew up with daddy gone. Mama had to make it with welfare checks. I used to go and shop with the food stamps. A lot of folks say that, but the way I know, Felonis, if you've been on food stamps, is I ask you what color was your food stamps. Because if you don't know the different colors, you just front. But I used to slip the little gray slip so my friends wouldn't know I was on food stamps. But Mama told me something I never forgot. She said, he may not be there when you want him, but he's always on time. The Lord will make a way out of no way. And I can tell you 40 years later, he walks with me. He talks with me. He tells me that I'm his own. He's been food when I was hungry. He's been watered when I was thirsty. He's my rock, my sword and shield, my wheel in the middle of the wheel. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He woke me up this morning, started me on my way. Yes, 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 yes. Let me say this. We got to go to the cemetery. Let me say this. I saw Michael Brown Sr. here, and I thought about, I told him this story. 9/11 happened, Congressman Green, and we were all flustered in New York. They closed down the bridges, closed down the streets, closed the trains. I had to walk all the way to my headquarters of Nash Action Network. When we got there, there were people everywhere. Cell phones was down and people came to our headquarters to see if we could tell them what was happening, whether we were out of danger. And for the first time since I was a little boy, I started preaching, as Bishop said, since I was a little boy, and I always had something to say, but first time in my life, I couldn't find words to say. And Jimmy, I went in my office. Terry Anderson, I trying to figure out what could I say. And I thought about this old preacher told me this story. He said, Al, I had to preach one Sunday, the early service, and I started reading this novel about 8 o'clock that night. And I got so into it that I couldn't put the novel down. I looked at the clock, it was 10 o'clock. I wanted to go to bed, but I couldn't put the novel down. It was so intriguing. And I kept reading it. Turned up, looked again, it was 11:30. I said, Lord, I gotta get some rest. I gotta get up too early. But I couldn't put it down. He said, I kept reading. Finally, it was after midnight. And he said that, Al, I gotta tell the truth. I decided then I would cheat. And I turned to the end of the book to find out how the story was going in. I want you to know on 9/11/2001, I want the family to know, like I told Michael Brown's family, that afternoon I cheated. I sat in my office and I took my Bible out. And I turned to the end of the book. And I know how this story is going to end. The first will be last. The last will be first. The lion and the lamb is going to lay down together. And God will take care of his children. We got some difficult days ahead, but I know how the story's going to end. There's going to be justice for George Floyd. There's going to be justice for Eric Garner. This story won't end like this. God will never leave us nor forsake us. I've been to the end of the book. Let's fight on. Let's stand together. Let us not leave this family now that the ceremony is over. This is the beginning of the fight. It's not the end of the fight. George, I read on the front page of the New York Times this morning, you said you wanted to touch the world. Well, God had already made you for that. But you didn't touch it in a basketball court or football court. God had something else for you to do. Because all over the world, George, they're marching with your name. You touched the world in South Africa. You touched the world in England. You touched every one of the 50 states. Even in a pandemic, people are walking out in the streets, not even following social distancing, because you've touched the world. And as we lay you to rest today, the movement won't rest until we get justice, until we have one standard of justice. Your family is going to miss you, George, but your nation is going to always remember your name, because your neck was one that represented all of us, and how you suffered represented our suffering. So we're going to lay you near your mama now. You called for mama, we're going to lay your body next to her. But I know mama's already embraced you, George. You fought a good fight. You kept the faith. You finished your course. Go on and get your rest now. Go on and see mama now. We gonna fight on. We gonna fight on. We gonna fight on. We gonna fight on.
Praise the Lord. I wrote this song 20 years ago, and I never thought I'd sing it for a game changer.
And so many open doors.
you know you're blessed. Wave your hand if you know you're blessed. Crystal Rucker, everybody. In the valley with tears in your eyes, Lorraine, take him to the valley.
For every mountain,
come on, sing it for George, sing it for George.
You brought me over.
For every trial,
Lord. See me through. For every blessed, my soul says hallelujah. For this,
take me to the valley.
I give you. Give you praise.
Have you earned the praise, God, on the mountain top? Come on, Lorraine, take me to the mountain.
you praise.
Just a few more moments. We've come to the termination of this celebration of life, and to God be the glory for the life of George Floyd Jr. Kirk Carr and the singers have just told us that we need to give God praise. The Bible says that let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. So let everything in this room, on behalf of George Floyd that hath breath, praise the Lord even right now. Let's praise God for George's life, for his legacy, for his memory. As we prepare to leave from this place, there are a few matters of order that must be considered as we prepare to leave. I'm going to ask everyone to please take your seat at this time. Everyone, will you please take your seat at this time? Thank you so very much. As we take our seats now, we're going to terminate this service, allowing the family to leave first. And then, because we must maintain order and get the family to the cemetery in an appropriate amount of time, the ushers are in the aisles and they're going to dismiss each section singularly. We're going to ask that you will stay in your seat until the usher has made it clear that it is time for your section to recess, to leave the sanctuary. I'm going to ask that you will do that, and it has been requested that you will go immediately to your cars so we can allow everyone to clear off of the campus of the Fountain of Praise as expeditiously as possible. We must maintain order. We must get this done so that the family can get to the cemetery and we can lay this body to the ground as we have celebrated his life in such grand fashion. Thank you, church, for being the church that you have been throughout this time. Thank you, beloved community, for hearing what we have asked of you and responding accordingly. We're going to leave from this place now, and as we do, we again celebrate what God has done by giving to us the life of George Floyd Jr. The Bible says, the Lord giveth, the Lord hath taken away. Now blessed be the name of the Lord. Will you help me bless the Lord as the family stands and prepares to dismiss from this place at this time? Funeral directors, we are following your directions, and all other members of the congregation will remain seated until the ushers have dismissed you. Thank you so very much. Fort Bend has something to present. Oh, please. Fort Bend, will you make your presentation at this time? Fort Bend Funeral Home.
Please just remain seated, just the family, in this section right here in the center. So we'll be decent and in order. We'll ask the family to follow the direction of Fort Bend Funeral Services.
Shall wear a crown. We shall. eyes shall see it fade. I shall see his face. One day I will. When it's all over, I can't wait to get there. When it's all over,
I shall.
Going through the center aisle, please do not crowd the family any further. Please exit through the side doors here. I don't see nobody moving this way. I need people to move this way. Or I need you to move that way, towards the front. Amen. We'll keep order in place. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Yes, yes. There we go. Yes, and you can come around to the front if you want to catch up with someone there through the lobby. Please exit. Thank you.
Washington Journal. Every day, we're taking your calls live, on the air, on the news of the day, and we'll discuss policy issues that impact you. Coming up Wednesday morning, the Washington Examiner's Jerry Dunleavy discusses the prosecution of former National Security Advisor Michael Flynn. The conversation continues with former U.S. Attorney Joseph DeGenova and R Street Institute National Security Fellow Paul Rosenzweig. Watch C-SPAN's Washington Journal live at 7 Eastern, Wednesday morning. And be sure to join the discussion with your phone calls, Facebook comments, text messages, and tweets.
Live Wednesday on the C-SPAN networks, the House Judiciary Committee holds a hearing on policing practices and accountability. The committee will hear from George Floyd's brother and family attorney Ben Crump. Other witnesses include Mark Morial of the National Urban League and Sherilyn Eiffel of the NAACP Legal Defense Fund. That's 10 a.m. Eastern on C-SPAN. On C-SPAN 2, the Senate returns at 10 a.m. to continue work on a bill to fund the national parks and public lands. And on C-SPAN 3, Treasury Secretary Steve Mnuchin joins the head of the Small Business Administration to testify about implementing the small business provisions in the CARES Act. New Jersey Governor Phil Murphy discussed his state's response to the coronavirus pandemic and Black Lives Matter protests during a virtual event hosted by Politico Playbook. Governor Murphy also spoke about reform he'd signed in New Jersey to address police conduct, including requirements of an independent review of officer-involved shootings.
Good Tuesday morning. I'm Jake Sherman, co-author of the Politico Playbook. I'm joined by my colleague and Playbook co-author, Anna Palmer, to host a virtual Playbook interview with New Jersey Governor Phil Murphy to talk about how the Garden State is handling the coronavirus pandemic, how the state is reopening, and what assistance he'd like from the federal